Hello, ocean people. What's up? Welcome back to part three, or welcome to, for the first time, to part three of how to practice your underwater photography at home. And I was trying to brainstorm ideas. I was thinking, well, could we talk about how to make a DIY snoot that can produce images of mantis shrimp like this? And then I thought, no, we can't go to the hardware store, so we're not gonna do that. We should be supporting buying gear from our local underwater camera retailers and dive shops as soon as we can. Now, there's so much we can talk about with Adobe Lightroom, but the suggestion was to talk about things we can take advantage of now when a lot of us have a lot of extra time on our hands at home in the evenings and the weekends. So we're gonna do a high-level pass on some of the main features of Adobe Lightroom. It should be useful if you're not yet using Lightroom, but also useful if you are using Lightroom. And I have a number of different tutorials that I'll be referencing throughout this. So if you want to do a deeper dive on any of the topics we'll cover, all you have to do is go see those videos on my YouTube channel, and they're anywhere from 5 to 15 minutes. So we're gonna talk about backups, file organization, importing and exporting, and basic keywording in search. Let's kick that intro and get on the computer. All right, here we go. Oh shoot, I totally forgot about the backups. Let's jump out of the computer real quick. Thanks for coming back out of there. Much easier to talk about backups in person. And best practices for storing your photos are to use an external hard drive. And the reason for that is that we don't want all those massive files and those folders full of massive files on our computer. The more we fill up that hard drive, the slower the computer might run. So best practice is to use an external hard drive for your Lightroom catalog and your Lightroom files. And for backing up our Lightroom photos, we want to have multiple copies. The reason for that is you could always lose a hard drive. You could drop it, you could have it in the basement that floods, you could have theft or just file corruption. Real simple. I've definitely had hard drives die and it's not fun. So you want to have multiple copies of your photos. A good system for this can be like counting backwards 3, 2, 1. So you want 3 copies of all of your photos. You want 2 different hard drives or 2 different copies on you, and you want 1 different copy or 1 extra hard drive at an alternate location. So no matter what, if you have 1 hard drive crash or even 2 hard drives crash, you still have 3 copies. If something would happen to your home, you still have a copy off-site. And that's the safest way to back up all your photos. Some people talk about using the cloud, and you can certainly use the cloud. I've found that it's just a lot of data to have on the cloud, and we start looking at hard drives that are so cheap these days for terabytes and terabytes of data, it's easier to get these hard drives. Now, I don't keep every photo I shoot. I do a big round of deletions right away, so I'm not storing hundreds and hundreds and thousands of extra photos on the hard drives. So it stays pretty lean and it's very manageable just with an extra hard drive system. If you're a video shooter, especially a 4K video shooter, that's a whole different game. You might want to start getting into RAID setups and more complex storage systems that way. And here we are on the computer. The first thing to note is that I am using the desktop version of Adobe Lightroom, which is currently called Lightroom Classic. If your Lightroom doesn't look like this because you're on a mobile phone or a tablet, you are likely using Adobe Photoshop Lightroom, which is a mobile app designed for mobile use, and it's going to be scaled down a lot and won't have a number of these features. So again, this is Adobe Lightroom Classic, which is designed for desktop, PC, or Mac. File organization. Now, this is a great thing to review and look at and maybe update when we're stuck at home. Now, yours might look like this. So look at the left-hand column underneath the navigator window here. You can drag it out so that you can actually read what your folders say, which is great. Now, I've cheated a bit. Normally, your folders will be here in this folders area. I've actually created a collection to mirror what my folders look like right here. And then this gives us the idea of what we're looking at, very basic. If you want to learn more about creating collections in Lightroom, then check out my tutorial dedicated to collections on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/BrentDurand. So in my underwater images, I will go by year, then I will go by region. So here I've got California and Philippines, and then I'll have specific areas within that region. So in California, I can start getting into my counties, which will grow through the year. And then Philippines, was at Atlantis, Philippines in January and got to shoot some photos in Port Aguilera. So this is how I do it. There's a number of ways to organize your files, but this is a great system and uses unique file names with the UW. My land photos would have underscore land so that nothing could ever be mixed up. Every single folder is uniquely named. The beauty of this in Lightroom is that this is how our raw files are structured on our hard drive, and we never need to go look at those folders on the hard drive because we're doing all of our photo work and all of our organization and all of our exporting final JPEG files through Lightroom, so we won't touch this too much. We can create virtual collections. Maybe it's based on different locations or types of marine life or colors or lenses or other criteria. All virtually, and it does not affect this original file structure. Even all the edits that we do in Lightroom are all virtual, so they do not affect the original raw files you have stored here. And that's one of the beauties of Lightroom. And now let's talk about importing and exporting basics. Now, I'm going to fly through this pretty quickly because I want to keep this video short and concise. Here we go. Let's select a source for importing. I'm going to use my new CR2 files. I've got some great photos I just shot that are on my camera card. Normally this import box will pop up as soon as the card is put in the computer. You can figure it that way or not to do so. I tend to like it like that because it's easy. Pop in the card, Lightroom decides to import the photos. Now, you always work left to right in Adobe Lightroom. So we're looking at the source where the files are coming from. Then we're looking at the files themselves. You can check, uncheck the ones you want to import. So what we're really looking at here is batch workflow, right? So we're importing a number of different photos. And then one of the things we can start to look at to really save time in our workflow is presets. Now I have two different presets videos on my YouTube channel, so be sure to check those out, youtube.com/Brent Durand. I've said it before, I'll probably say it again, but this is huge. So when you're looking at the right-hand side, file handling, this is something you want to take a look at and update while we're at home. I tend to like standard previews built. You can do a number of different previews, but in terms of speed for cycling through your photos once you start reviewing them, build standard previews, and that will help you when you're jumping back and forth between images because Adobe won't have to create the preview as you're clicking towards it. It will be built already. I also like build smart previews checked. Now, build smart previews is really great because when you're using your external hard drive, you obviously have access to all the files, but smart previews allow you to access all your files up to a certain resolution without the hard drive. So let's say you want to crank out some metadata and some keywording while you're on an airplane, but you don't want to get your hard drive because it won't fit on that little tray. And like, well, where do I put my hard drive? Do I put it in my lap? And then the computer is on top. Forget about it. Just break out your laptop and you can update your photos. You can edit without the hard drive. And then once you plug your hard drive and that library back in, Lightroom will update everything in the background. So I love having these smart previews built, at least for my most recent photos, the most recent year or two. Don't import suspected duplicates. So let's say I'd imported these jelly photos before. Basically, Adobe would show me my photos like this. Now, this is great because if you already imported some photos, you don't need to go through and say, which did I import, which did I not import. But you want to keep in mind, never just put your card back and forth between the computer, the camera, computer, the camera, because you're going to increase chances of that memory card corrupting. I tend to take it out of the camera, put it in the computer, and then it sits aside until I can reformat it. So quick note about that. But as long as we're at home, we've got the file handling taken care of. Now we're looking at file renaming. And this is where, again, I get into presets. So I have a template for renaming my files. You can start to explore presets here. And what I've done, let's actually take a quick look on this preset, is every file that comes into Lightroom has my name, it's got a unique date, and that has an image number. Now, I know there's never going to be the same date over and over again, and if I shoot a lot on a same date, I'm going to have a different image number. So by using this system, one, I can export photos for clients, they know who it came from. Two, I know in the file name when it was shot. And then three, I have an image number, so there's no chance of redundancy throughout my whole photo career, unless dates repeat, but I doubt that's going to happen. So look at creating a template for renaming your files, then you don't have to worry about changing it in camera either. Develop settings. So this is another preset you can build yourself using my other tutorials, and that applies edits to your photo on import. Now we're importing all of these images. Imagine if I had to edit all of them one by one doing my basic global changes. It would take forever. With one click, on this particular preset, all these basic changes are going to be applied to the images by the time I look at them once they're loaded into Lightroom. Boom, done. Metadata and keywording, which we'll talk about in a second, all my default metadata and keywording is in there. Boom, done. One click, it applies to all the images. Now, these are really the time-saving things. If, let's say, I've got a number of photos that are all the same, I can start to apply keywords now that are going to apply to all of these images. Another time saver. As we go down, you can pick the destination. We talked about file organization and folder structure, so we know where we're going to save these images. Boom, let's import. And let's quickly talk about exporting. So file, export. Notice I had selected a few different images, so I'm exporting a batch. You could also export a single image. Now I've got this export dialog box that pops up, and it's sort of like the import dialog box where you can apply a number of different presets to the photos as you're creating those final JPEGs. So what you're doing is your raw file is being read by Lightroom, you've got all your editing you've done applied to it, and now what you're going to do is apply export settings to create a JPEG. So you'll be able to determine the size of the file, the type of the file, and a few other criteria. Now, export location, pretty straightforward. Just pick a place you like to export your files on your computer. File naming, you have an ability to add presets here too. So generally what I like to do is keep my exports as my typical name that I've changed on imports, but you could do something custom if you wanted to. Oh, there's custom. So cool photo. If you wanted to do a custom name here, again, this is a preset that I've got for file names. Video settings, we're not talking about video right now. File settings, generally export as JPEG unless you want some other type of format. JPEG's usually good for pretty much everything. Color space, sRGB is great for anything you're using online. Just leave it at sRGB. Quality, you can move the quality or limit file size if you wanted to. I generally like the quality at 100%. As you go down, image sizing, so depending on what you want to do with your image, if you want optimal resolution for Facebook or for Instagram to try and work around their compression algorithms. And then sharpening, you can sharpen the image here if you want, and you have to be very careful because if you're doing a lot of sharpening during the editing process and you apply sharpening here again, let's say a high amount, then your image is going to look a lot sharper on export than it did when you were editing it. So keep this in mind if you're going to apply sharpening on export, and you'll have to go very gingerly on the sharpening when you're editing. Then you get down to any extra metadata, and if you want to include the metadata, generally, all metadata is good because that's got your copyright in theory and some of the other things we worked into those presets we learned about earlier. So we'll skip metadata. We'll go down to watermarks. And this is another opportunity to watch one of my videos on YouTube. And you guys know where to find it. It's on my YouTube channel /Brent Durand. But watch my entire tutorial on how to create and edit watermarks. So I'll put my main watermark on there. And then any sort of other post-processing, I generally don't worry about that. The other big thing here is you can create presets that handle all of these export settings. So if I have very specific places I want to put images, specific sizes I want to have for the images, with watermarks, without watermarks, I can do all of this and I can create an export preset that remembers all of that. So if I go Instagram one by one, boom, now I've set that up, I'm gonna hit export and I'm gonna be done. And keywording and search. Are you guys ready? We're gonna keep this clear and concise. Now I've picked my image and we're always working left to right in Lightroom like I had mentioned. And the library module right here, which is before the develop module as we move right and start editing our actual photos. The library module is where we want to stay organized and really work on some of the folder structure for our images. You see in the left column, let's create some more space for us right here. And then also the whole right column, which allows us to do a couple quick settings. I don't play with all that much, but mostly our keywording and organization. So here you go. You can see I've entered a number of keywords for this image. And this is a great thing to do when we're at home and we have some time. Put in the subject, put in what's happening, put in anything you can think of that will help you to find this image later. But the real value with Lightroom here with the keywording is the search. So we can do a Command or Control F right here, and it pulls up our library filter. And you've got a number of filter and search criteria here. which I'm not going to dive into too much because I have a VIP video, of course, about mastering search, which dives in depth on all of these different search criteria and how to filter your images. So with keywording, let me go and I'm going to search for starfish. And now I've got my starfish photos. Boom, keyword search. The cool thing that you can do once you look back to your file structure is you can go up to higher level files and start searching for all your starfish across all the different years, or maybe in certain places. So you can look for all the nudibranchs you've ever shot. You can search for all the nudibranchs in a certain place you've ever shot. You can search for everything with the color green or with the color purple or all the urchins. Whatever it is, you can search by all those criteria, and that's what makes Lightroom so powerful, is if you do a good job with your keywording over here, you're going to be able to find your images later by doing search. So get in there, put Latin names, put whatever you can think of that makes sense for the image in there now while we're at home, and that's going to really help you searching later on. Now, it gets a little more advanced than that too. You can have keyword suggestions. I tend not to use that all that much in Lightroom, but you can have keyword sets. So if there's certain things you'll use in a lot of different images, you can create these kind of like presets, but they're keyword sets that just allow you to group certain presets together that you tend to use a lot. So you can come into an image and just start clicking your presets and add them right in there, and they're all applied. It just makes it very, very easy to do batch editing with presets for one image or two at a time. So now if they're very similar images, I can do all the things I see, which are urchins and starfish, sea stars, and create accurate keywording. So that's pretty much it. Check out my video, Mastering Lightroom Search, on my VIP video channel if you really want to dig in here. And there we go. I hope that was useful, and I hope you're going to go explore, watch some of these other tutorial videos for deeper dives into learning Adobe Lightroom and some of these really, really powerful features that help improve our workflow and speed up our editing process. If you haven't yet, hit that subscribe button. If you have any questions, leave comments below. I'll do another arrow thing, because the comments are right there, or they should be if you're on YouTube. So leave your comments there. I'll try to answer everything I can, provide links to other resources, even other instructors. You know, let's have at it. Let's make this a community. And also go to my website, tutorials.brentdurand.com, where you can subscribe to my newsletter. You can set up virtual photo lessons where we can have one-on-one exchanges and all sorts of other resources, gear guides, and different tutorial articles. So thanks for tuning in. I'll see you guys in the next video.